aching cold. These hands are meant to hold.
Face to face. When all you gotta keep is strong. Move along like I know you do. And even when your hope is gone, move along just to make it through. Move along. Move along.
Okay, now that we've spent some time talking about the equipment, let's spend a little bit of time actually talking about the different places that we monitor. Let's look at each individually. So let's start with arterial lines. We've already talked about arterial lines a bunch, but just to review, remember we said that when we put in an art line, we usually put it someplace as far distal as possible. Usually in adults, that means that we're going to put it in the radial artery. Again, usually in small children, what we end up using is the femoral artery. And remember we said the big advantage to the art line was it allows for continuous real-time monitoring of blood pressure. As soon as we see changes in the blood pressure, as soon as the patient experiences changes in blood pressure, we're obviously going to see that reflected on the art line. Now, when we talk about why art lines are placed, although the big advantage is the ability to monitor real-time blood pressure, in reality, most of the time when art lines are placed in the ICU, they're placed for a completely different reason. Most of the time when we place art lines in the ICU, we're actually placing them to give us a ready access point to get arterial blood for multiple blood gases and lab draws and things like that. Now, that's not necessarily a good practice. In fact, there's actually been several studies that have looked at using art lines for that reason, and they've found that while adding an art line to a patient's treatment regimen does increase the amount of lab work that's done, it typically does not do anything to change the mortality or the morbidity for patients who are just having that art line placed for lab work value. So there's really kind of a trend to try and stop doing that. Usually now we're being a little bit more critical about who we put an art line in. Now, when we talk about an arterial waveform, this is a good example of an arterial waveform, and this is a waveform that you need to know well. You need to know what an arterial waveform looks like. Now, as we look at this waveform, you see that each cardiac cycle is characterized by a sharp upstroke, a sharp downstroke, and on the descending side of the waveform, on the downstroke side, we see that there's the presence of a dicrotic notch. Now, remember that the dicrotic notch, what it exists for is it denotes closure of the valve that's immediately behind the catheter. So for instance, when we're talking about a peripheral arterial line, remember that that peripheral arteries don't have valves in them. So as we go backwards, the first valve, if you will, that you're going to come in contact with is actually the aortic valve. So in a peripherally placed arterial line, you'll see that the dicrotic notch denotes closure of the aortic valve. Now, remember, if somebody's got an aortic valve that's incompetent, that dicrotic notch may be really, really small, or it may even be non-existent. So when we have a good dicrotic notch, that typically means we've also got a good aortic valve. Now, when we talk about the arterial waveform, remember that the peak at the very top, that's our systolic blood pressure. The base at the bottom, right before the start of the next beat, that denotes our diastolic blood pressure. And also, when we talk about mean arterial pressure, remember mean arterial pressure is obviously everything that's under the curve. So again, the peak at the top is systolic blood pressure. The base at the bottom of the art line is obviously our diastolic blood pressure. And then everything underneath is the MAP or the mean arterial pressure. Now, when we talk about central venous pressure, remember we said the big reason why we get a central venous pressure is to give us an indication of preload for the right side of the heart. Now, one thing you do want to know about CVP, and we can actually make this generalization of any pressure that we use to get a preload number. Any pressure where we're using it to assess preload, so for instance, when we're using CVP, we're using it to assess preload for the right side of the heart. Any preload number is always going to be measured as a mean number. So with CVP, we don't have a top number and a bottom number like we do with most types of blood pressure or heart pressure. With CVP, we just have one number, and that number is the mean. And you need to know what a normal CVP is. And so for an average adult, a normal CVP is somewhere around 2 to 6. For kids, it's usually a little bit higher, maybe somewhere in the neighborhood of 6 to 12. Remember again that when we talk about central venous pressure, things that are going to decrease it are going to be things like hypovolemia, if the patient's vasodilated, if the patient has a decrease in their venous return, let's say they've got some kind of, say, aortic stenosis, or excuse me, some kind of vena cava stenosis that's preventing blood from effectively coming back to the heart. If the patient has decreased venous return because of something like a tension pneumo, or if the patient has a lot of pressure in their abdomen, they've got intra-abdominal hypertension, all those things are going to decrease venous return, so those things are going to drop the CVP. The other thing that actually drops the CVP is negative pressure ventilation, which we know is normal, healthy ventilation. As you inhale in and you inhale out, that actually creates changes in pressure in the chest that actually slightly decrease your central venous pressure. Now, when we talk about things that are going to increase the CVP, things that would obviously increase it would be things like hypervolemia. If the patient's got a right-sided heart failure, very quickly blood is going to back up into the right atrium into the central circulation. That's going to increase our central venous pressure. If the patient has a cardiac tamponade and blood can't get into the heart because the heart's being crushed, obviously that would increase our CVP. If the patient's on positive pressure ventilation, that's going to increase our CVP. And remember that anybody who has pulmonary hypertension is going to have an increased CVP. Remember when we talk about pulmonary hypertension, we said the big reason why people get pulmonary hypertension is because they're hypoxic in their lungs. So, for instance, we can see an increase in the CVP in patients who have CHF and pulmonary edema. We see it all the time in people with COPD. We see it in people who have pulmonary emboli. Any of those things that are going to cause hypoxia. And this really brings us to an important point. When we're talking about hemodynamics, people really tend to make hemodynamics a lot more complicated than they are. Remember that hemodynamics is just plumbing. And we all know from plumbing that if we've got a pipe and we've got flow of fluid that's moving from left to right, if we put an obstruction in the pipe, say we put an obstruction right here, we all know that everything coming up to the obstruction is going to be high pressure. We know that everything past it is going to be very low pressure. Well, when we talk about CVP, if you want to think about what makes CVP high or what makes CVP low, just think in terms of plumbing. If we've got a obstruction, i.e. like let's say we have right ventricular failure, and because of that the right ventricle isn't effectively pushing blood out, well, that's our point of obstruction. So what's going to happen to everything behind it? It's going to be high pressure. So when my right ventricle fails, very quickly blood backs up into my right atrium, backs up into my central circulation, my CVP goes up. Now, when we talk about other things that would cause an increase in the CVP, some other things that might be that obstruction in the pipe, if you will, might be things like patients that have tricuspid problems. Remember that if we have tricuspid regurge, every time the right ventricle contracts, some of that blood is going to go backwards up into the right atrium, so that's going to increase the CVP. In contrast, if I've got tricuspid stenosis, if it's very hard for my tricuspid valve to open, same thing. Blood is going to back up in the right atrium. That's going to increase my central venous pressure. So just saying that the CVP is high or low in and of itself doesn't create this magic solution to your problems. We really have to know why. And so remember again that the value in hemodynamic monitoring is not sticking in a catheter, getting a number, and going, oh, it's blah, 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 so this is what's wrong with the patient. The real value is in being able to trend that number and see what happens as we start to treat the patient. When I do this for the patient, does it make their CVP better or worse? When I do that, does it make their CVP better or worse? So again, we said a normal CVP was 2 to 6, certainly a number you need to know. Obviously, anything higher than 6 is going to be an increase in the central venous pressure. Anything less than 2 is going to be a decrease in the central venous pressure. Now, when we look at a central venous pressure waveform, this is a waveform that you need to know really, really well. And when we look at this waveform here on the bottom, when we look at this waveform in the left lower corner, this is a good example of a central venous waveform. We need to know what the various waveforms look like because it's very important as we put a swan in, as we're managing a swan, to know where the tip of that swan is at. So you definitely need to know what a CVP waveform looks like. And the easiest way to describe a CVP waveform is it's a low amplitude, gentle rolling kind of waveform. It almost looks like fine V-fib. And if we were to take that central venous waveform and we were to expand it way out, we would actually see that every cardiac cycle actually has three little bumps to it. Now, in reality, most of the time when you look at a CVP waveform, it's so low amplitude that you're not going to see three bumps for each cardiac cycle. Instead, you're only going to see two. So if I was to say the easiest way to describe a CVP waveform, I might say that it just looks like a series of cursive M's, like the letter M as in Mary. So you've got like one little M, next little M, next little M, and each one of those M's is one cardiac cycle. So when we look at the CVP waveform, really what we're typically going to see is just the two little bumps, but if we blew it way out, we'd actually see that there's three bumps. And we actually label those three bumps as an A wave, a C wave, and a V wave. Now the A wave is actually caused by the atria contracting. As the atria starts to contract, that's obviously going to increase the pressure in their atria, and that's also going to increase the pressure in the central circulation, so we get that first little positive deflection. Now the C wave actually happens as the ventricle starts to contract. Remember, as the ventricle starts to contract, blood wants to go backwards. As that blood wants to go backwards, it actually slams the tricuspid valve closed, and the tricuspid valve actually bulges up into the right atrium. So that bulging up into the right atrium causes an increase in pressure, and we see the second waveform, the C waveform. Finally, as the right ventricle is contracting and the tricuspid valve is closed, blood is still coming into the atria. So as that blood is coming into the atria, we're seeing the third waveform, which we call the V waveform. Now, we also talk about things called descents, and when we talk about the X descent is actually just the downside of the A waveform, and the Y descent is actually just the downside of the V waveform. So when we look at this waveform that's just below me here, you see that there's six little bumps. The first three bumps would be one cardiac cycle, A, C, and V, and then the second set of bumps would be another cardiac cycle, and there we've just labeled the descents and not the bumps. Now remember again that typically in the real world we don't ever see the C wave. It's so small that we usually don't see it. Usually we just see the A wave and the V wave. And again, the A wave denoted that the atria was contracting, and the V wave denotes that the atria is passively filling with blood as the tricuspid valve is closed and the right ventricle is contracting. Okay, so remember again with the central venous waveform, the big thing to take away is remember we're looking for a nice, gentle, rolling kind of pattern. We're looking for a very low amplitude pattern, typically going to look like a series of cursive M's. The next place where we actually monitor pressures is actually in the right ventricle. When we monitor pressure in the right ventricle, the right ventricular pressure waveform looks very, very different. We'll talk about that in a few minutes, but first let's talk about what the right ventricular waveform means. First, when we talk about right ventricular waveforms and right ventricular pressures, the first thing you need to know about them is that we don't typically monitor right ventricular pressures. This is a waveform that you absolutely positively have to know. You have to know exactly what a right ventricular waveform looks like, because we never want to see this waveform from any catheter tip. So whether it's a central line or whether it's a pulmonary artery catheter, we never want to see a right ventricular waveform, and the one exception to that is we're obviously going to see a right ventricular waveform as we're actually putting a Swan in, but once the catheter is in place, we don't ever want to see a right ventricular waveform. So you need to know what it looks like so that if you see it, you know something is really, really wrong. Now, when we talk about the right ventricular pressures, remember things that are going to increase your right ventricular pressure are going to be the same things that are going to cause an increase in the CVP for the most part. So things like pulmonary hypertension, patients who have left heart failure that moves over and becomes right heart failure, patients who have cardiomyopathies on the right side like cor pulmonale, patients who are fluid overloaded, all those people are going to have increases in their right ventricular waveform. Now, when we talk about things that are going to decrease right ventricular pressure, obviously it's going to be very similar things to what would decrease the CVP. So if the patient's massively vasodilated, if the patient's dry and doesn't have enough fluid, all those things are going to decrease our right ventricular pressures. Now, you need to know what a normal right ventricular pressure is, and since a right ventricular pressure is not a measure of preload, we actually use a systolic and a diastolic, so you need to know what a normal systolic and a normal diastolic are. A normal systolic ventricular pressure is somewhere in the neighborhood of 15 to 25. We would expect to see that in a normal healthy person, their right ventricular systolic pressure is going to be about 15 to 25 millimeters of mercury. Their diastolic pressure is going to be somewhere in the neighborhood of 0 to 5. So when we think about right ventricular waveforms, the big thing to think about is the fact that a right ventricular diastolic pressure is very, very low, very close to zero. The other thing that really hallmarks a right ventricular waveform is the fact that right ventricular waveforms do not have a dichrotic notch. That's an important point and one you need to remember. Remember, a right ventricular waveform does not have a dichrotic notch. Now, remember we said that we don't ever want to see a right ventricular waveform in a line that's already been placed. Well, why is that? The big reason we don't want the tip of any catheter to be sitting in the right ventricle is that the right ventricle is a very, very sensitive ventricle, and anything that's moving around inside of it that's not blood tends to cause ectopy, and that ectopy can be anything as benign as an occasional PVC or can be as anything as major as VTAC or VFib. So we never ever want the tip of a catheter to just be sitting in the right ventricle. The only time we should ever see a right ventricular waveform is in the patient who's having a Swan floated, and all we do when we're putting in the Swan is we move into the right ventricle, identify that we're in the right ventricle, and continue our movement on into the pulmonary artery. We don't leave it sitting in the right ventricle. Now, when we talk about right ventricular waveforms, well, why would we have a right ventricular waveform? Well, obviously, besides the floating in the Swan, the other two times when we may potentially see a right ventricular waveform, first is when a central line has been placed too deep. And this happens a lot when people are inexperienced to putting in central lines. They'll advance a central line, and because they're not as familiar with the procedure as they should be, they'll advance the central line too far, and the central line will actually move from being in the central circulation or right atrium into being into the right ventricle. Well, that tends to cause lots of problems, which we said can be anything from PVCs to VFib or VTAC. So if you go in to take care of a patient who's got a central line in place, that's one of the first things we want to do when we transduce it, is we want to look and see if it's in the right ventricle. If it is, it needs to be pulled back into the right atrium. The other place where we can see right ventricular waveforms inadvertently is when a patient has a Swan in place and that Swan inadvertently migrates backwards into the right atrium. That also is a really bad thing because we've got the tip of a catheter sitting in the ventricle irritating it. So that Swan needs to either be pulled back or it needs to be advanced in the pulmonary artery so that it is not sitting in the right ventricle. So what does a right ventricular waveform look like? Well, when we look at this waveform here in the right lower corner, when you look at that waveform, if it was an EKG, what would you think it was? Well, when you look at that waveform, and if it was an EKG, the big thing you would think is, oh, that's VTAC. Well, if it looks like VTAC, then we need to think it's a right ventricular waveform. Right ventricular waveforms in a lot of ways look very similar to VTAC. Now, when we talk about the right ventricular waveform, the ways that we would describe it is we would say that it has a very sharp upstroke, very sharp downstroke. Remember that the right ventricular waveform does not have a dichrotic notch. And remember, the dichrotic notches are always on the descending side. The right ventricular waveform does have a notch, but the notch is actually on the ascending side. That's a hallmark thing that you need to remember. When we're talking about right ventricular waveforms, remember the right ventricular waveform has a sharp upstroke, sharp downstroke, and has a notch on the ascending side. Well, what is that notch? Well, that notch is actually atrial kick. Remember the way that your heart works. Most of the blood that comes into your heart goes right through your right atrium and plops down into your right ventricle because your tricuspid valve sits open when you're at rest. As your right ventricle gets ready to contract, the right atrium contracts first, and that tops off the right ventricle. That topping off is what causes that slur on the right ventricular waveform on the ascending side. So that tells us that we've got atrial kick. So obviously, if the patient has got an atrial waveform, or if the patient's got atrial activity that's synchronized with the ventricles, we would expect to see that notch. But remember, if the patient's got like AFib or something like that, or if it's a junctional rhythm or a ventricular rhythm, then we won't see that stroke or that slur on the ascending side. But if the patient's got an intact atrium, we're going to see that there's going to be a slur on the ascending side, and we know that that's not a dichrotic notch because dichrotic notches are on the descending side. We know that that is atrial kick. So you need to, right off the bat, be able to identify the difference between a CVP waveform and a right ventricular waveform. Remember, with the CVP waveform, we said it's a very low amplitude, gentle rolling kind of waveform. Looks a lot like a series of cursive undercase M's. In contrast, remember, the right ventricular waveform has a sharp upstroke, sharp downstroke, and also has a notch on the ascending side. Now, one last thing that's worth mentioning about the right ventricular waveform is, remember, with the right ventricular waveform, your diastolic pressure is going to be very, very close to zero. And if somebody's really hyperdynamic, we may even see that the diastolic pressure is zero or is even a negative number. Remember that it's almost like there's a sucking of blood as that ventricle relaxes, because remember that as the ventricle is contracting and the tricuspid valve is closed, blood is continuing to collect in the atrium. When the ventricle does its contraction, and then as soon as it relaxes, that tricuspid valve pops open, and when it pops open, all that blood that had been collecting in the right atrium plops down in the right ventricle. So it's almost like there's a sucking effect to that right ventricle. So our diastolic pressure in a right ventricular waveform is going to be very, very low, like close to zero. Okay, let's move on to our next waveform. If we were putting in a central line, we would only see that the patient either had a CVP waveform or a right ventricular waveform. We would know that if we had put in a central line appropriately, we would see a CVP or a right atrial pressure waveform. If we had put it too far in, then we would have seen a right ventricular waveform. But what about when we're actually floating a pulmonary artery catheter? Well, when we're floating a pulmonary artery catheter, we're actually going to advance the catheter into the central venous circulation, move it into the right ventricle, and then as soon as we move into the right ventricle, we're going to inflate the balloon and we're going to advance it further. As we advance it further, the next waveform that we're going to see is something that looks like this. This is a pulmonary artery waveform. Now, before we talk about the actual what it means and all that good stuff, let's just look at the waveform real quick since we're on that subject. When you look at this waveform down here, this waveform that's down at the bottom here on the left bottom side of the screen, when you look at that waveform, what does it look like? What other waveform looks just like that? Well, that looks just like an art line waveform. Remember that an art line waveform has a sharp upstroke, a sharp downstroke, and an art line waveform has a dichrotic notch. And when we look at this waveform here, we see there's a sharp upstroke, we see there's a sharp downstroke, and we see that there is a dichrotic notch. Well, why do you think it looks like an art line waveform? Because it is. It's a pulmonary artery waveform. So when we think about a pulmonary artery waveform, if you want to know what a pulmonary artery waveform looks like, it looks like an art line, because that's exactly what it is. It's an art line that just happens to be sitting in the pulmonary artery. Okay, so when we talk about the pulmonary artery waveform one more time, remember that we're going to have a sharp upstroke, we have a downstroke, and on the downstroke side, we will see a dichrotic notch, assuming that the pulmonic valve is competent. Now, when we talk about a PA waveform, just some things to think about with the PA waveform. When we talk about the pulmonary artery waveform, when we actually measure pressure in the pulmonary artery, we're actually getting data about both sides of the heart. We're getting data about the right side of the heart and the left side of the heart. Remember that when we talk about things that are going to increase your pulmonary artery pressure, it's going to be things like if the patient is fluid overloaded, if the patient has got a ventricular septal defect, that increases the amount of blood flow that's coming to the pulmonary artery, so that can cause an increase in your PA pressures. We're going to see it in any patient who's hypoxic because their pulmonary artery vasoconstricted. We see it in patients who have left ventricular failure. We see it in patients who have mitral valve problems. All those things are going to increase our pulmonary artery pressures. And if you think about it, it goes back to our whole rule of plumbing. Wherever there's an obstruction, everything behind it is going to be high pressure. Wherever there's an obstruction, everything past it's going to be low pressure. So if the obstruction is, say, my mitral valve, let's say that it's either stenotic or incompetent, then obviously blood is going to back up into my left atrium, then it's going to back up into my pulmonary arteries, and because it does that, my PA pressures go up. Same thing if I've got a left ventricular MI. If I've got a left ventricle that's failing and that left ventricle can't effectively contract blood, that blood is going to back up into the left atrium, back up into the pulmonary arteries, and lo and behold, my PA pressures go up. Now, what about the things that are going to drop the PA pressure? Well, the big things that are going to drop the PA pressure are the things that are going to drop all your other pressures. So, for example, if the patient is massively vasodilated, that's going to drop our PA pressures. If the patient is dry, if the patient is hypovolemic, that's going to drop our PA pressures. So what are normal pulmonary artery pressures? Well, this is another set of numbers that you need to know. You need to know what a normal pulmonary artery systolic and a normal pulmonary artery diastolic pressure are. So when we talk about a normal pulmonary artery systolic pressure, a normal systolic pressure for a nice healthy adult is somewhere around 15 to 25 millimeters of mercury. Well, what does that sound like? Well, remember that a right ventricular systolic pressure was also about 15 to 25. Well, if you think about that, that absolutely positively makes sense, because where does the pulmonary artery get all of its blood flow from? Well, it comes from the right ventricle. So whatever the right ventricle's maximum pressure is, that's also what the pulmonary artery's maximum pressure is going to be. Now, when we talk about a pulmonary artery diastolic pressure, that's normally about 8 to 15. Remember when we were talking about a right ventricular diastolic pressure, we said that was normally about 0 to 5. And if we think through the physiology of this, this makes sense too. Because as the right ventricle contracts, it pushes blood up into the pulmonary artery. So the systolic pressure is going to be the same. Remember, as blood rushes up into that pulmonary artery distends and then has a rebound back. And as it rebounds back, some blood wants to go retrograde back into the ventricle. But what prevents that from happening is that pulmonic valve slams shut. That pulmonic valve, remember we said a long time ago when we started this cardiac section, we said the pulmonic valve, what it exists for is to maintain diastolic pressure in the pulmonary artery. So when we're looking at waveforms and we're trying to figure out whether somebody's got a right ventricular waveform or somebody has got a pulmonary artery waveform, one of the first things we do is we actually look at the bottom of the waveform. If it's a right ventricular waveform, the bottom is going to be really close to zero. If it's a pulmonary artery waveform, we're going to see that there's going to be a little bit higher pressure. And as we're actually advancing the swan in somebody, as we're actually floating a swan, that's how we know we've moved from the right ventricle into the pulmonary artery. It's not so much that the top of the waveform changes, it's that the bottom of the waveform starts to come up as we move into that pulmonary artery. Now, when we talk about pulmonary artery, let's look at one more waveform right here. This is a beautiful example of a PA waveform. Remember that when we talk about the PA waveform, we're going to see a sharp rise with systole. Then we're going to see that the waveform starts to come down as the patient goes into diastole. But the hallmark of a PA waveform is, remember that with the PA waveform, the patient will have a dichrotic notch. So remember, when we compare the PA waveform to the right ventricular waveform, there's two ways that we can tell them apart. The first one is, remember that on the bottom of the waveform, the PA waveform is going to have a higher bottom than the right ventricular waveform. Now, more important than that, the better way to be able to tell them apart is, remember, with a right ventricular waveform, we're going to have a notch on the ascending side. And that notch on the ascending side, we said, was atrial kick. With the PA waveform, we're going to have a notch on the descending side, and we know that that notch on the descending side is the dichrotic notch, which is closure of the pulmonic valve. Okay, so going back to floating our swan here, let's say that we've advanced it in the pulmonary artery. We now see this pulmonary artery waveform. Well, we're not done yet. We're going to keep advancing the waveform, or keep advancing the catheter with the balloon inflated, till we finally get to a point where we actually create something called a wedge. And when we look at this waveform here, these are two different examples of wedge waveforms. The one that's on the right lower screen is probably the more accurate portrayal of what a wedge waveform looks like. Now, when we wedge the waveform, when we actually wedge the catheter, remember what we've done is we've continued to move that catheter with the balloon inflated till we've gotten to a point where we've actually moved that catheter to a point of no return, where it can't go any further because of the balloon being inflated. Remember that as we move into the pulmonary circulation, as there's bifurcations of blood vessels, they're going to get smaller and smaller, the lumens. As we're advancing this catheter, we're going to move it till we move it into a smaller and smaller lumen until we get to a point where it's at a dead end and it can't go any further as long as that balloon is inflated. Remember, we said the reason why we wedge the catheter is actually to separate the right side of the heart from the left side of the heart. So when we wedge the catheter, what that allows us to do is see what the pressure is on the left side of the heart. Because remember that when the heart is sitting in diastole, the mitral valve is going to be sitting open. And because the mitral valve is open, when we measure blood in the left ventricle, the column of blood that goes from the left ventricle up into the left atrium, up into the pulmonary venous system and into the pulmonary arteries is all going to be one pressure. It's all one continuous column of fluid, so it's all going to be one pressure. So when we talk about the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, you need to know that the reason why we wedge the catheter is to get an idea what the left ventricular end diastolic pressure is. So in other words, when we talk about the wedge, the easiest way to conceptualize the wedge is the exact same thing as the CVP. It's just preload for the left side of the heart. So I'll say that again, because this is the easiest, most simple way to understand this. When we talk about CVP, we said CVP was a preload number, and we said that the reason why we measure somebody's CVP is we want to know what the preload is for the right side of their heart. When we talk about the wedge is also a preload number. It's the exact same thing as the CVP in function, except that we are measuring preload for the left side of the heart. Now, remember we said anytime we measure a preload number, we're not going to measure systolic and a diastolic. We're always just going to use a mean. We said that so a normal CVP, the mean is somewhere around 2 to 6. Well, when we talk about wedge, it's the same way. We're just going to use a mean. The left ventricle is a little bit higher pressure than the right ventricle is, so you need to know what a normal wedge is, and a normal wedge is somewhere around 8 to 12. So again, that means that the mean left ventricular end diastolic pressure is somewhere around 8 to 12. Okay, so let's talk about this. Now, when we actually are talking about the pulmonary capillary waveform, remember that we said that the way that we get it is we inflate the balloon and we allow the catheter to migrate to a point where it comes to a dead end where it can't go any further. Remember that once we've inflated that balloon, we have created a pulmonary embolus. As long as that balloon is inflated, we have created a pulmonary embolus. Now, that brings us to an important point. This wedge waveform that we're going to talk about in just a few minutes, the only time you should ever see a wedge waveform is when you make it a wedge waveform. We don't want people to sit in a wedge because as long as that balloon is inflated, they've got a pulmonary embolus. So we only want the wedge waveform to be visible to us when we've actually put a patient into a wedge to measure their left ventricular end diastolic pressure. So how do we do that? How do we wedge the catheter? Well, we've already talked about the fact that when we're floating it, we're going to move it till it comes to the point where it actually wedges. But once the catheter is in place, once we've actually floated our Swan and it's actually in place and we've got our wedge, then what we do is we actually deflate the balloon. Well, when you deflate the balloon, if this is the pulmonary artery right here, and when the balloon was inflated, it was completely occluding it, then obviously when I deflate that balloon, obviously that should allow blood to pass by again. So what do you think is going to happen to our waveform? Well, obviously what we're going to see is that the waveform is going to change back into a pulmonary artery waveform. So when the balloon is inflated, we see a wedge waveform. When the balloon is deflated, we see a pulmonary artery waveform, and that's assuming the catheter is where it's supposed to be. So remember we said to get an indication of what left ventricular pressure was going to be, we would inflate the balloon. And when we inflate the balloon, we generally don't want that balloon to be inflated for any more than probably about 15 or 30 seconds or so. Usually when we get a wedge, what we're going to do is we're going to inflate the balloon, we're going to allow the patient to take a couple of breaths, allow pressure to equilibrate, and then we're going to get our wedge. And then as soon as we've got our wedge, then we're going to deflate the balloon and we're going to allow blood to pass by again. Now, when we talk about the inflation of the balloon, there's a couple of safety things you need to know. The very first thing that you need to know is you need to know what the maximum amount of air that balloon is designed to hold. And it depends on the Swan, but most of our adult Swans, the maximum amount of air that they're designed to hold is actually 1.5 cc's of air. So that balloon actually can hold up to a cc and a half of air. Now, does that mean that when we wedge the catheter, we put in a cc and a half of air? No. Absolutely, positively not. What that means is that that's the maximum amount of space that balloon can hold. Well, why is this such an important thing? Well, one thing you always want to remember about a Swan, this is really, really important. Whenever we put a Swan in somebody, the big reason Swans get such a bad rap is because if you put a Swan in somebody and that Swan is managed by somebody who's been poorly trained, there's the very real potential that we could do significant harm to the patient by inappropriately using the Swan. And the number one thing that people do wrong with the Swan is they inflate that balloon to its maximum pressure, to 1.5 cc's of air. Well, in a patient who's got a pulmonary artery that's smaller than that 1.5 cc's can fit, if we inflate that balloon to maximum pressure, we can actually rupture the pulmonary artery. And if we rupture the pulmonary artery, this is kind of the big thing about pulmonary artery catheters, if we overinflate that balloon and we rupture the pulmonary artery, then 50% of patients with a pulmonary artery rupture will die from it if that pulmonary artery rupture happens in a tertiary care facility. So if that pulmonary artery was to rupture somewhere else, say in transport or in a non-tertiary facility that didn't have cardiovascular surgery, the mortality would even be higher than the 50% it is in a tertiary care facility. So how do we know how much air to put in the balloon? It's actually really simple. All we're going to do is when we wedge the catheter, we're going to inflate that balloon very, very slowly, nice and gently. And all we're going to do is put air in the balloon until we see the waveform change, until we see it change from a PA waveform to a wedge waveform. As we're pushing air into the balloon with our little syringe, very gently, as soon as we see that that waveform changes, we stop putting air in. We don't put any more air in. So let's say that you've only put in half a cc and you see that waveform change to a wedge waveform. Well, then you're done. At that point, you don't add any more air in. You just stop there to half cc. You allow time for everything to equilibrate, let the patient take a breath or two, and then we see what our wedge is, and as soon as we've seen what our wedge number is, then we're actually going to deflate the balloon, and the balloon is designed so that it'll passively deflate on its own, so all you gotta do is let go of the syringe, and the balloon is going to come back down. As the balloon comes back down, what we should see is that the wedge waveform changes back into a pulmonary artery waveform. So again, remember the important thing is while the balloon is maximally designed to hold 1.5 cc's, that doesn't mean that's how much you put in. You only put in enough air to get a wedge. Okay, so let's actually look at what a wedge does for us and what it means. Remember that when we talked about a wedge, we said the big reason why we wedge the catheter is to get an idea what the pressure is in the left ventricle. So what do you think is going to cause the wedge to go up? Well, the number one reason that the wedge is going to go up is because of left ventricular failure. And if you think about that, that makes sense, because when I wedge the catheter, basically all I'm doing is I'm looking straight through the pulmonary artery into the pulmonary vein, into the left atrium, and right down into the left ventricle. So if that left ventricle is failing, if it's not doing its job because it's ischemic or hypoxic or whatever, as blood continues to move from the right to the left, what we see is the left ventricle starts to distend and the pressure inside becomes higher and higher. So the number one reason why the wedge would be up is actually because of the fact that the left ventricle is failing. Now, when we talk about other things that are going to cause the wedge to go up, we can also see this if we've got mitral problems. Remember, if the mitral valve is really, really stenotic, it's going to be hard for blood to move from the left atrium down to the left ventricle. So there, what we're going to see is the left atrium distends, blood backs up, and we see an increase in the wedge. Conversely, if the mitral valve is incompetent, every time that ventricle contracts, some blood is going to be pushed backwards up into the left atrium. That's going to increase left atrial pressure, and it can actually have enough force that it can actually push back into the lungs and cause the catheter to actually be pushed backwards, and we may not even be able to wedge the catheter. So all those things are going to increase our wedge. Well, what's going to decrease our wedge? Well, it goes back to all those things that are going to decrease all of our pressures. If the patient is hypovolemic, that's going to decrease our wedge. If the patient is vasodilated, that's going to increase our wedge. And remember that the other thing that can increase our wedge is right ventricular failure. Well, why would right ventricular failure cause our wedge to be low? Well, remember our rule about plumbing. If we've got a pipe and fluid is going from this way to this way, wherever I have an obstruction, everything up to the point of the obstruction is going to be high pressure. Everything past the obstruction is going to be low pressure. So if I've got right ventricular failure, like let's say I've got a right-sided MI, then obviously my right ventricular pressures are going to be high, my CVP is going to be high, I'm going to see blood is going to back up and I'm going to have JVD. But on the other side of that ventricle, i.e. in my pulmonary arteries, my wedge is going to be low. So remember again, when we talk about the wedge, remember we said that it's measured as a mean. We can say that the wedge is the exact same thing as the CVP, it's just for the opposite side of the heart. So we measure CVP for the right side of the heart, we measure the wedge for the left side of the heart. Now, we've talked a whole bunch about the wedge. Let's look at the waveform here. When we look at this waveform, what does that waveform look just like? It looks just like a CVP waveform. And remember that it looks like it because essentially it's the same thing. It's just for the other side of the heart. With the wedge, we're measuring preload for the other side of the heart, for the left side of the heart. So what you're going to see with the wedge waveform is the same things that you see with the CVP waveform. Typically, it's going to be very low amplitude. If we were to expand it out, we would see an AC and a V wave. But in real life, we typically don't see an AC and a V wave. We usually just see the A and the V wave. So it looks like a series of undercase cursive M's. And we know that each M or each two humps equals one cardiac cycle. Okay, let's look at what it looks like as we actually advance the catheter through the heart. If we were actually floating a swan, what we would see is in this graphic here in the right lower corner, we would see that we start, as we're very first pushing the swan in, we see a gentle rolling kind of waveform, and we know that that's the CVP waveform or the right atrial waveform. As we advance it a little bit further, we advance it in the right ventricle, and remember that when we move into the right ventricle, the way we know that happens is there's a dramatic change in the waveform. We see that all of a sudden the waveform goes into a sharp upstroke, sharp downstroke, and we also see that there is a clear notch on the ascending side. We know that notch on the ascending side is atrial kick. And as we advance the catheter even further, as we look at the second line of this graphic, what we see is that the top of the waveform doesn't really change, but as we advance it in the pulmonary artery, the bottom comes up, because remember the diastolic pressure increases because of that pulmonic valve closure. And the other thing that we see as we advance this catheter on is we also see the presence of a dicrotic notch form. So as we move into the pulmonary artery, we've got the presence of a dicrotic notch. And finally, as we continue to advance the catheter in, we're going to move it to a point where it wedges. And we know when it wedges because as we continue to move it on, we see a fourth waveform. We see that we go from being in a pulmonary artery waveform to back into a nice gentle rolling kind of waveform. And we know that we are now in a wedge position. Now remember, once we're in a wedge position, what we're going to do is we're going to allow a couple of breaths for the patient's pressures to equilibrate. We're going to get our wedge, and then as soon as we have our number, then what we're going to do is we're going to deflate the balloon, and we expect that when we deflate the balloon, the catheter is going to change back into a pulmonary artery waveform. Okay, now let's talk about just a couple of quick troubleshooting things here. Let's say that you're transporting a patient and the patient actually has a waveform that looks just like what it's supposed to look like. Let's say they've got a swan in place and we see this nice pretty pulmonary artery waveform that we're supposed to see. We've got sharp upstroke, good downstroke, got a dicrotic notch. It's definitely in the pulmonary artery where it's supposed to be. And let's say that as you're transporting this patient, all of a sudden you look over and you notice that the waveform has changed. And when you look at it, it is now a nice, gentle, rolling, low amplitude kind of waveform. Well, what has most likely happened? Well, most likely the waveform has wedged. So what does that mean? So that means that the waveform has wedged, and we know that if there's a wedge, as long as there's a wedge, the patient, in essence, has a pulmonary embolus, right? So we can't just have the patient sitting in a wedge. So what do you do about it? Well, remember, the very first thing that we're going to do is we're going to actually go back and we're going to track our tubing and we're going to find that syringe. And we're going to make sure that the syringe hasn't inadvertently been pushed. We want to make sure that there's not any air in the balloon by pulling just gently back on the syringe, make sure there's not any air in the balloon. Now, let's say you've done that and you're still sitting in a wedge. Then what do you do? Well, a lot of times the difference between being in the pulmonary artery waveform and being in a wedge waveform for a catheter may only be just a fraction of an inch. So a lot of times just having that patient cough forcefully, just having them or just having the patient move to one side or the other, a lot of times that in and of itself is all you have to do to get the patient's catheter to move that little fraction of an inch backwards to where we're back in a PA waveform. Well, what if you have the patient cough? What if you have a move and they're still in a wedge? Well, then the last thing that we can do for this patient is we can actually pull the catheter back. Now, remember, when we pull the catheter back from a wedge waveform into a PA waveform, we're not talking about like pulling it back. A lot of times it's just pulling it back again, just a fraction of an inch, just pulling a little tiny bit will actually move the catheter back into a PA waveform, and then we're happy and we're good to go again. Now, what if you're taking care of a patient and the patient's got a beautiful pulmonary artery waveform, and when we look at the waveform, everything looks good. We've got a sharp upstroke, we've got a downstroke, we've got a dichrotic notch, we're definitely sitting in the PA artery, everything's going great. And then all of a sudden, a few minutes later, you look over and your patient's throwing a bunch of PVCs. Well, knowing what you know that if the patient's got ventricular ectopy and they've got a Swan in, the first thing we always think of is that the line has moved. So we look over at our waveform, and sure enough, we have moved from being in a PA waveform to being in a right ventricular waveform. We've got a sharp upstroke, we've got a sharp downstroke that goes all the way down very close to zero, and we now have a hump on the ascending side, so we know for sure we're sitting in the right ventricle. So now what do? Well, basically, we have two choices, and this is very much guided by your policies, procedures, and what your facility or your transport program allows you to do. If you are in a program, like let's say you're working in the hospital where you're not allowed to manipulate the waveform, the line at all, you're not allowed to move it one way or the other, then the first thing that you want to do is you immediately want to inflate the balloon and lock the balloon inflated. The reason why that's important is because when you inflate the balloon, it makes it softer than the tip of the catheter. So if that catheter is going to be sitting in the ventricle for a few minutes until somebody can get there and move it, it decreases the chances that the patient is going to have ectopy or go into VTAC or VFib. Now, what if you're actually in a transport environment where you actually have protocols and policies that allow you to move the catheter? Well, there's two things that you can do here. Both of them are appropriate, and they both very much depend on your comfort level with dealing with Swans, what your policies are, what your protocols are, and the patient condition. One of the things that we can do is we can actually just pull that Swan back until we're in a CVP position. So all we would do is we would just grab the Swan and we would gently start to slowly pull it back until we actually see that we go back into a CVP waveform. Now, there's advantages and disadvantages to doing that. The advantage to doing that is obviously it gets it out of the right ventricle. The disadvantage is once it's been pulled back, it typically can't be pushed back in. So once it's been pulled back in that CVP position, then we're probably going to have to get rid of that Swan and put another one in. Now, the one thing you want to remember is if we're going to pull it back, then what we want to do is we want to make sure that before we start pulling, that we deflate the balloon. We inflated the balloon to give us kind of a second to figure out what was going on. And then when we decide, okay, I'm actually going to pull this back into a CVP position, we always want to deflate the balloon. By deflating the balloon, we prevent damage from occurring to the tricuspid valve. Because remember the way the tricuspid valve is designed, it points down. If I had that balloon inflated and I pulled back, what would happen is I would damage the leaflets of the tricuspid valve. That's called a valvostomy, and cardiologists get paid to do that. We don't. So obviously that can be a pretty problematic thing, so we want to make sure that the balloon has been completely deflated before we pull the catheter back. Now, the other option that's available to you if you use Swans a lot, you're very comfortable with them, and you have policies and protocols that allow you to do this, is we could actually try and refloat the Swan. So if we were going to do that, remember what we're going to do is we're going to keep the balloon inflated, and we're going to slowly advance the Swan through the cortis, and we're going to allow the Swan to move back into its pulmonary artery position. And remember, because the balloon is inflated, we want that Swan to be moved all the way back into a wedge. Once that Swan is back in a wedge, then what we're going to do is we're going to deflate the balloon, and we should see that when we deflate the balloon, lo and behold, the waveform goes back to being a pulmonary artery waveform. Okay, let's switch gears here and let's actually talk for just a few minutes about some common drugs that we use in cardiac pharmacology. This is just a very kind of down and dirty kind of review of some of the things that you may see on the exams and some of the drugs that we use to manipulate hemodynamics. So let's start with beta blockers. We've already talked about beta blockers a little bit in the cardiac section, but remember that beta blockers, their whole kind of purpose in life is they block the body's response to adrenergic stimuli. Remember that the reason why we would use beta blockers is to decrease oxygen demand on the heart and decrease its workload. So when we talk about indications for beta blockers, basically we're going to use beta blockers anytime we want to slow the heart rate or we want to decrease contractility. And so the classic example of that is usually in MIs, we have a goal that we want to keep the heart rate between 60 and 80 so that we decrease oxygen demand on the heart because it's ischemic. Now, when we talk about beta blockers, you need to know the contraindications, and there's a couple of them. For the most part, most places still consider heart failure to be a contraindication to beta blockers, although we talked about how that's kind of changing. We actually see that beta blockers are being used more and more in heart failure, especially the beta blocker Coreg or carvedilol. When we talk about other contraindications, another big contraindication is any kind of ventricular conduction disturbance. So we usually don't want to give beta blockers to anybody who's got a first degree block. We don't want to give it to anybody who's got a second or third degree block. We don't want to give it to anybody who's got a bifascicular block or anything like that. Now, the other big contraindication of beta blockers is any patient who is in active bronchospasm. Remember that just having a history of asthma in and of itself is not a contraindication of beta blockers. But if I'm in active bronchospasm, obviously I need to treat that active bronchospasm with beta 2 sympathomimetics. But if I was to give the patient beta blockers first, then I'm just going to block all those receptors and I'm not going to be able to treat their bronchospasm. So a history of asthma doesn't make a contraindication to beta blockers. But if the patient's in active bronchospasm, then we don't want to use beta blockers. Now, the other drug that we use here, or the other drug that we're going to discuss on this slide is dobutamine. And the reason why I put dobutamine and beta blockers together is because if you understand what a beta blocker does, then it's really easy to understand what dobutamine does, because dobutamine is the exact opposite of a beta blocker. So when we talk about dobutamine, remember that dobutamine is purely a beta drug. And this is an important teaching point. A lot of people, especially when they go through their initial education, they're taught about dopamine and they're taught about dobutamine, and they're taught about them as almost being like synonymous drugs, like kind of having the same kind of effects to them. Or a lot of times, like in cardiac classes, dobutamine is lumped in with pressors. If you remember nothing else about dobutamine, remember this. Dobutamine is not a vasopressor. I'll say that again. Dobutamine is not a vasopressor. It is not the same thing as dopamine. It is a very, very different drug than dopamine. And the reason it's different is because, remember, dobutamine is purely a beta drug. It's only a beta drug. So that means that it has beta 1 effects and it has beta 2 effects. Well, remember from our discussion about the autonomic nervous system, we said that when we talk about beta 1 effects, that means it's going to increase heart rate and it's going to increase contractility. But remember that dobutamine also has beta 2 effects. And what did beta 2 do? Beta 2 causes vasodilation. So when you put somebody on dobutamine, yes, you're going to increase their cardiac output. Yes, you're going to increase their heart rate and stroke volume. But yes, you are also going to vasodilate them. So dobutamine is not a drug that we use for people who are hypotensive. Putting somebody on dobutamine is not going to increase their blood pressure most of the time. Most of the time when you put somebody on dobutamine, if it's going to do anything to their blood pressure, it's actually going to decrease it. So we usually use dobutamine for people who need an increase in inotrope, who need an increase in heart rate, but who are not hypotensive. If the patient has decreased contractility, has a decreased rate, has a decrease in cardiac output, we may use dobutamine, but we're only going to use dobutamine after we control their blood pressure first. So that's why a lot of times what we'll do is we'll put patients on dopamine to get their pressure up, and then we'll add dobutamine to improve their heart rate and contractility. Okay. When we talk about phosphodiesterase inhibitors, some of the big phosphodiesterase inhibitors are drugs like amarinone and milrinone. And the big thing to remember about phosphodiesterase inhibitors is the way that they work is they actually increase intracellular cyclic AMP. Okay, well, what in the world does that mean? The short and the sweet of it is the easiest thing to use to describe phosphodiesterase inhibitors is that they have the same effects as dobutamine, except they're not dependent on the sympathetic nervous system. They work on the cells directly. They work inside the cells. But the net result of what we're going to get from a phosphodiesterase inhibitor is the same as what we're going to get from dobutamine. So phosphodiesterase inhibitors, we use them as inotropes to increase contractility. We use them to increase cardiac output by increasing heart rate as well. But remember that just like dobutamine, your phosphodiesterase inhibitors are also going to cause vasodilation. So the indications for phosphodiesterase inhibitors are the same as the indications for dobutamine. So we would use that in people that we want to increase their cardiac output and who we want to vasodilate. Now, when we talk about the specific phosphodiesterase inhibitors, the big thing to remember about amrinone is that it has a tendency for causing thrombocytopenia. So if we've got a patient who's already got a low platelet count or a patient who has a threatened or has the threat of coagulopathies, we probably don't want to use amrinone. And because of its thrombocytopenia, we've actually seen that amrinone is really decreased in use. Most of the time what people use now is milrinone. But the one thing you want to know about milrinone is milrinone has the potential, although it be a small potential, to cause ventricular arrhythmias. Okay, let's talk about dopamine for just a few minutes. We've all used dopamine lots and lots. Just a quick review. Remember, when we talk about dopamine, remember it has both alpha and beta effects. At low doses, like doses of less than 5 mics per minute, remember that dopamine is primarily a dopaminergic drug. So what does dopaminergic mean? It means that at low doses, less than 5 mics per minute, 5 mics per kilo per minute, basically all we're going to see is an increase in renal perfusion and an increase in mesenteric perfusion. So the big thing to remember is when we're putting somebody on dopamine, we usually are putting them on it to improve their blood pressure. At a dose of less than 5 mics a minute, you're not going to increase their blood pressure. In fact, if you're going to do anything, you're actually going to decrease their blood pressure because you cause renal arteries to vasodilate and you cause the blood vessels in their gut to vasodilate. Well, for years we used low-dose dopamine as a renally protective drug. That was kind of this thought process for years. We would use what we called renal-dose dopamine. We now know that renal-dose dopamine does do one thing for you. It does increase blood flow to the kidneys, and it does increase blood flow to the mesentery. And we do know that low-dose dopamine, renal-dose dopamine, does cause an increase in urine output. And that was the whole reason why we used it. We said, okay, well, if we put them on low-dose dopamine, it's kidney protective because it'll make the kidneys keep peeing. It does cause the kidneys to keep peeing, but the pee that they're putting out is worthless. It's basically just all water. So low-dose dopamine really is not indicated anymore. When you look at the literature, the whole idea of using renal-dose dopamine has basically gone out the window. Yes, it does increase urine output, but it's worthless urine output, so we really could care less about that. So low-dose dopamine is kind of like a thing that has gone by the wayside in most institutions. Now, when we talk about moderate dosing for dopamine, typically what we're talking about is putting on the patient on anywhere from 5 to 10 mics per kilo per minute. When we put patients on moderate doses of dopamine, between 5 and 10 mics, basically what we're getting is beta effects. We're getting beta 1 and beta 2 effects. So we're seeing an increase in heart rate, we're seeing an increase in contractility, and because we're at beta doses, we actually do see some beta 2 effect, which remember we said beta 2 causes vasodilation. But the thing that's different about dopamine compared to dobutamine is even at moderate doses, there is still some alpha effects. So the alpha effects combine with the beta effects to basically cross each other out. So when we put somebody on moderate doses of dopamine, we're getting an increase in heart rate, we're getting an increase in contractility, but we really don't have any vasodilation because while we do have beta 2 sympathetic stimulation, we also have some amount of alpha 1 stimulation to oppose it. Now, once we get to higher doses of dopamine, once we get over 10 mics, once we start getting into that 10 to 20 mic per kilo per minute dosing range, basically all we're doing is giving the patient an alpha drug. All we're doing is giving them a massive increase in their systemic vascular resistance. Now, remember that when we put people on high doses of dopamine, a lot of times once we get them up to 10 and 20 mics, they get really, really tachycardic. Well, if it's only an alpha drug, then why would they get tachycardic if they were on high doses of dopamine? Well, remember back to our hemodynamic rules. If I increase the systemic vascular resistance, if I start to vasoconstrict everything down like I do when I'm giving somebody a purely alpha drug, what is that going to do to cardiac output? It's going to decrease it because it's a lot harder to push that blood out. So anytime the patient has a decrease in their contractility, they are going to reflexively get tachycardic. So when we talk about high-dose dopamine, remember that that's almost purely alpha. Basically, all we're doing is vasoconstricting down. And that's not a benign thing because we're also doing a lot of damage to the heart. We're making the heart work really, really hard. So we use dopamine certainly to get the blood pressure up when we need it. But we don't want people just sitting around on dopamine. We want to get rid of dopamine as quickly as we can. So if there's a readily reversible reason why the patient is vasodilated, then we would, reversible reason why the patient's blood pressure is so low, then we would certainly want to fix that reason as quickly as possible so that we can get the patient off of high doses of dopamine and we can decrease how hard that heart is having to work. Now, if you understand what high-dose dopamine does, then it's really easy to understand what Levofed is. When we talk about Levofed, Levofed is a drug that is almost purely alpha. At very, very low doses, like less than 2 mics per minute, we see a little bit of beta effects. We see a tiny bit of beta 1. But the doses that we typically use it at in critical care, usually we're using doses of anywhere from like 2 mics to 30 mics. That's almost all alpha. So remember again that that norepinephrine is basically in and cause massive vasoconstriction. That's what it does for it. It's an alpha 1 drug. So when we talk about Levofed, Levofed's a drug that got a really big black eye for years and years and years because the drug was actually doing exactly what it was supposed to do, and the problem was that we thought the drug was this really crappy, horrible drug, but in reality, we as clinicians were not smart enough to be using it in the right people. You probably, if you've been doing this a long time, you probably remember when we used to say things like, oh, Levofed, it's a terrible drug, we should call it Levimdead, all it does is kill people. Well, that's because we were using it in completely the wrong people. We were giving it like to people in cardiogenic shock. And you all know now from our discussion of cardiology, the people who are in cardiogenic shock, they don't really need a bunch of vasoconstriction. They've already got that pretty much figured out on their own. Levofed is the drug of choice for people who are in vasodilatory types of shock or people who are in distributive shock states. So people with things like anaphylaxis, people who are in the warm stage of septic shock, people who have things like spinal cord injuries and spinal shock. Levo is your drug of choice for those patients because it causes massive vasoconstriction. Now, one other thing that's really advantageous about Levofed compared to some of our other pressors is Levofed is also probably one of the best drugs in patients who are really, really acidotic. If you've got a patient who's really, really acidotic, a lot of times all your other pressors won't work, but lo and behold, when you start them on Levofed, Levofed will. Now, when we talk about the contraindications, obviously we wouldn't want to give it to somebody who's got any kind of occlusive vascular problem, and we also don't want to give it to any patient who's got a hypersensitivity to sulfites. And remember, again, the dose is 2 to 30 mics per minute, and we obviously titrate that to effect. Now, if you understand what Levofed does, it's also really easy to understand neosinephrine. Neosinephrine does essentially the exact same thing Levofed does. Neosinephrine is a very potent alpha stimulator, and we use it for the exact same reasons that we use Levofed. We use it to increase somebody's systemic vascular resistance. So we use it, again, in those distributive shock states. We use it like for people with sepsis. We use it for people who have things like spinal shock or patients who are in anaphylaxis, things like that. Remember that when we talk about neosinephrine, one of the advantages of neosinephrine is that we can actually give it as a bolus or we can give it as an infusion. Usually when we give it as a bolus, we give like 0.1 to 0.5 milligrams really slowly. When we start a drip with somebody with neosinephrine, usually what we'll do is we'll start at like 100 to 180 mics per minute and we're going to titrate it to get the blood pressure back up, and then we're going to usually use a maintenance of somewhere around 40 to 60 mics a minute. The big thing to remember with neosinephrine though and with Levofed is that when we massively vasoconstrict a patient, we dramatically increase the workload on their heart. So while we can give this drug to people with cardiac disease, if we're in a rock and a hard place, when we do that, we're doing that at the cost of damaging their heart even further. So we really try to avoid using our alpha drugs, whether it's Levofed or neosinephrine, in patients who have a history of coronary artery disease or ischemic heart disease.